So we are back again with the topic of this Linux programming classes, right? Wait for some time so that all can join. Let me tell everyone. Okay, so the scenario is that we have covered almost most of the topics of this Linux programming under the syllabuses, the theoretical part and all of the scenarios, and we are doing the programming part one by one in the laboratory and other classes. Okay, today I just want to get back to the theoretical part, right? So we have a discussion previously on the topic of this IPC and shared memory related discussions, but to enhance that, to particularly more to talk on it, I am going to talk on this particular IPC and shared memory related chapter again, how the scenario goes on in more depth actually. So the thing is that in the process of this IPC, the inter-process communication is actually it is actually transfer of data among the processes. So if we write the scenario of IPC, so what is this IPC? We can say that transfer of data among the processes, right? So this is the basic definition. We can talk about this IPC, the transfer of data among the processes. Now example, considering that an web browser, suppose any Google, Mozilla, any type of web browser actually requesting for a web page from a web server. So server is there, a server where we are requesting some data, and against that we are getting that data. So the server, a web browser, is actually requesting a web page from a web server, which sends some HTML message or HTML request, right? So the web browser is sending some HTML request to the web server for a web page. The scenario is like that. This transfer of data is a one-way communication first, because the sender is, while the sender is doing some request, at the time nothing can be done, only the request is going on, and to acknowledge that, again the data or acknowledgement part we are getting, right? So the transfer of data usually happens with some socket programming scenario, where the web browser from the client side is actually requesting for some data to the server side. A client server scenario is actually follows here. So this processes or the communication of the different processes between the different types of processes, the topic is known as the inter-process communication. And basically, if we talk about this inter-process communication, there are five types in general that is need to be understand. That first one, the shared memory that permits the process to communicate by just simply read and write for a specific memory location. So what is the first part? If we write, shared some memory, actually shared memory actually permits the processes. Shared memory permits the processes to actually communicate, or simply reading and writing for the communication. We can have shared memory permits the processes for the communication between in a single memory location, between on a memory location, just by read and write permission. These two, read and write permission, was given for a single memory location. The memory is shared, and the shared memory is permitting actually this part for the communication between the processes by simply writing and reading permission given to a specific memory location. The second part, that is mapped the memory, except that is associated with a file in a file system. So the second part, that is mapped memory. We need to map the memory, that is our second part here. Third one, we can say that pipe scenario, that actually giving or helping us for the sequential communication from one process to another process. The third one, we can say piping scenario. Pipe scenario for the communication of one process to another process. Fourth one, that is the FIFO structure. That is first down, first out, first in, first out structure. That unrelated process can communicate, where the unrelated process can communicate. So FIFO, the FIFO structure is there where the unrelated process can communicate, right? So fourth one, we can say FIFO structure. And last, the fifth one, we can say socket scenario. The socket programming, we can talk about where some inter-process communication between the unrelated process on the different computers. The socket programming giving the support of sharing the memory or sharing the data between the processes on different computers. So these are the basic five types of this IPC. The inter-process communication is there. Now these types, how we actually find out this type? This type is actually identified by the actually different criteria. There are some criteria on which we have actually do this IPC segment or IPC differentiation. What are those? First, that the restrict communication to an unrelated process. The restriction between the communication to the processes to or the unrelated processes sharing the same file system or a computer that is connected on a network. So first of all, the scenario, the unrelated process, there are some restrictions, there are some boundations for the communication of those processes. Or the communicating process is limited to only write some data or to read data, because if a process have the proper permission for write, then no other process can have the permission of writing that data at the same time. The number of processes permitted to communicate it and the communicating processes are synchronized by some IPC or inter-process communication. So these are the following criteria on which the different types of this IPC is going on, such as restrict the communication between the unrelated processes, number of processes that can be permitted for the communication, the permission of the read or write data. This type of following criteria are there to execute that. Now, this shared memory concept, the inter-process communication that is actually performed by using the shared memory process. This is the most simplest process or communication process that used. So shared memory is used for the inter-process communication. What happened here in this part of shared memory? So what happened here in the process of this shared memory actually, that the processes, two or more processes, access the same memory, right? So they are trying, two or more processes are trying to access the same memory. Suppose calling some malloc, the malloc function they are all calling to access some memory. Okay, malloc and this type of functions we are there, you know, and have the value of trying to access the same memory. So what happens when two or more more processes are actually trying to access or trying to connect with a similar memory location? And suppose one of these have some permission of write actually, then if any changes happen or any rewriting changes happen, then that change will be reflected, or the modification will be reflected to all the other processes. So the first, the thing is scenario in the shared memory, multiple
processes are trying to access a same memory.
In this scenario, the processes, the modification is happening. First, what happened? The communication. So all the processes sharing the same piece of memory here, that is trying to access that same memory, and access to that particular memory that is being shared between all the processes. Multiple processes are trying to access that. So when it is shared between the multiple processes, so access to this memory or shared memory needs to be very fast, right? Access to this shared memory needs to be very fast. But as the process memory needs to be shared between all, and is not require any type of entry for the kernel and copying any data unnecessarily, because sharing the memory does not lead us for any copying data, because that memory from directly there the processes can actually have the data, so no need to copy and place somewhere else. Now this kernel that is always there to support any type of process or any type of work, the kernel here does not actually synchronize the access of shared memory. So here the kernel is not playing any type of role for the shared memory, whereas the IPC segment or the memory that is being shared between the processes, they need to synchronize their role. Suppose, and as an example, we can say that a process, more than two processes are having the data or having access to a memory, one is having the write and has to be. So the thing is, when an operation of write is going on that particular memory location, the other processes that have the read permission on that particular process will not read the data. It is only going to read the data when the writing operation was done from a process. Till the time the writing operation was not over, the data will not be read. Because if the data is read and the process was working on that data that was read previously, and after the modification it has some changes, so then it will not actually giving us a result properly, or there will be some error. So when one write operation is happening or going on, the other reading operation will be in some wait mode, so that until the time the writing operation was closed, then only they actually have the data. And then there have no type of modification, they have the modified data already. No new modification will be there as there is no writing operation. So the time a process will not read from the memory until the data is written there or the modification was done. So there is a condition, there is a race condition, we can say, that all the processes are trying to access the same type of memory location having the data. So there to solve this particular problem or to avoid this type of conditions, we use some techniques that is generally known as the semaphore technique. And that semaphore will be discussed obviously in the later part. So the single process that is accessing the memory, focusing on that shared memory mechanism to avoid any clustering of the synchronization logic, right? So what happened in this memory or this shared memory model process we will talk about? So through a shared memory segment, when we are trying to use a shared memory segment, one process must have an allocation of the segment, means the rewriting data. And other processes are required or desired to access the segment by attaching with it. And when the processes work was done and the task was finished, they need to detach themselves also, because maybe some other processes need it and they are not getting it as it is fully occupied. So some other processes need to get the data. So that's why when the task was done, when the process was completed, they need to detach itself also. So this memory, that model here actually helping the allocation and the attachment process, where this may process virtual memory is split into different pages. And each process maintains a mapping from its memory address to the virtual memory pages. So whenever a memory entry is happening, the table will actually have the log to check the address with respect to the virtual memory pages. So how this allocation is actually happening? the allocation process, the process actually allocates a shared memory using a particular function. What is that function name? The function name is SHMGET. Shared memory gate. The particular thing is known as shared memory gate. So the process, a process allocates a shared memory segment using this SHMGET function, the shared memory gate function. Here the thing is, in this part of SHMGET function, the parameter, the first, it is a key, or it is a numbering integer key that specified which segment to allocate. What segment we need to allocate. First that thing was done, and then the allocation process goes on, right? So here the process that is not related to that memory, the unrelated process we can say, can also access the same memory or same memory segment by specifying that particular key value. So if multiple processes are actually trying to access the memory location with the same key, then it will be reflected as some conflict. So here, to avoid this conflict, every processes has some unique thing so that there will be no type of conflict will be there. So some IPC private particular signal key was generated or was there to find out or to allocate the memory segment as created. So the term is IPC private. By this term, it can be actually used, right? So the this parameter, the number of bytes that can be specified in the segment, all the things will be there. So the bitwise or the flag values, the specific options of this SHM get function. The SHM get function has some specific options, specific values or flag values there. What are the flag values that is present under this SHM GET function? First one we can talk about IPC create. The first one we can talk about IPC create. So this is the first parameter or first flag value we can say that is present that is in the part of this SHMGET function. The flag value that is helping us to indicate a new segment that should be created. So this flag indicates that a new segment that is to be created and permits of creating a new segment by specifying a new key value. So in this part of this IPC create, with the help of this IPC create, the flag, we are indicating that a new things need to be created and new value needs to be assigned in that particular creation. Second one, that is IPC EXCL. The next flag value that is present here, IPC EXCL. So what happened in this part of IPC EXCL? It is actually used by this SHMGET function to for the fail if a segment key is specified that already exists. So suppose we are trying to create a new segment key, but that was already there. So that means that creation will not be happening. There will be a failure scenario. So that SHMGET function, while trying to create a new segment, and if that is already there, then there will be a failure. It will be a failure we can talk about. Therefore, so if it is failed, so if the things already exist, then what happens? So then what is actually happening, that it arranges for some calling process for an exclusive segment. So this EXCL is the term of exclusive segment. And if the memory was already there, or the segment that we are trying to create that was already there, a flag will be not be given, means a new flag value will not be created, and the key of the existing segment will be used. That was already created, that we are trying to create it, it is already there, then we are trying to get the key of that particular one. Right, so these are the flag values that are present or helping us for the SHMGET function for the process. So this process of this SHMGET functions creates some new shared memory segment or giving us some access to an existing one. So there are two scenarios, trying to create a new one, or either it is present, then to
access that one, access that particular segment, right? So there is some read and write operation was there for the users. Some have the read operation, some have the write operation permission. So that is another issue, right? So the segment was created, or whether it is present already, then the same previous key was will be used for the process. So the process between the processes of this SHM, GET, the memory, shared memory segment already exists, the permissions was verified, all the things was going on. Now the thing is that attachment and deattachment. Attachment and detachment will be there. So as I said previously, that the memory is shared between several processes, and when it is actually going to work on it, the premier who have the write operation, they are actually trying to attach that is the prime key, primer location that have the facility or write the access, and rest of the keys are trying to attach with it for their purposes, right? Now when I'm trying to attach and having the access of the memory, when my work is done, when the work of the process is done, a process to make that shared memory segment available again, a process must use some SHMAT, that is called shared memory attach, or pass it to the shared memory identifier, some SHMID return to the SHMGET particular purpose. So SHMAT, that is the shared memory attachment, and SHMDAT will be there for some shared memory deattachment process. To attach and deattach, these particular calls will be there for the attachment and deattachment of the processes with respect to the shared memory, with the time of this shared memory. So this permissions of bits are used for the files for the particular shared memory processes. And SHMCT1, this is the system call again, SHMCT1. This is used for to control the shared memory. The term SHMCT1 is used for shared memory control. So call returns information about a shared memory segment and have can modify the thing of read or write whatever. So the parameter for the shared memory segment is identifier. The first thing that we need, that is needed as an identifier, and to obtain the information about that shared memory segment. And if we need some of information about the shared memory segment, the table, the data, whatever the things that happen, we need to have a particular signal, that is IPC stat, as a second argument for the particular process. And to remove a segment from that IPC or the shared memory, we can use this IPC RIMD to remove a particular segment of the process. To remove a particular segment of the process, we can use this IPC RIMD, RMID. These are the things. Now, through the process of this shared memory segment, it has an advantage of this first bidirectional communication among any number of processes. So there is advantage one we can say, that is bidirectional communication very fast bidirectional communication between any number of processes. So that is that bidirectional communication among any number of processes, bidirectional communication between any number of processes, that is happening here, right? Now the part that each user, the process or the things, we can say that can have the both or read or write any of the permission, but a program must look for it, so that only one at a time have this write performance and other have the read operations, other having some read operations. So this process is for this shared memory segment, arrangement of the same key, then the processor term here known as the semaphore. The thing first, before starting the semaphore, the thing is needed here, the processes actually needs to coordinate it. All the things we have talked about till now about the processes, if there is no coordination, then the thing will not be worked properly, right? So we first, the thing is the coordination of the process needs to be there. So the coordination between the processes must coordinate with each other to access a shared memory. to access a shared memory here, right? So the semaphore here actually working as a counter that permits the synchronization multiple threads of the process, right? So the semaphore is here actually working as counter that permits the synchronization process. So this system, the Linux or the Unix-based system, the implementation of semaphore will be there for use for synchronization process, right? Some the process semaphores will be allocated, used, and deallocated, like using the shared memory segments. And this process segments or the semaphores, we can talk, is sufficient for almost all of the uses from the process semaphores, from the creation, allocation, detachment, deallocation. All the process can be used through this semaphore. Now let us see first the process of allocation and deallocation, and then we will be looking for the initialization of the semaphore. Right, first the thing is allocation and deallocation of semaphore. So what is happening? The allocation and deallocation of semaphore, some SEMGT, same gate, semaphore gate, and semaphore SCT1, semaphore control, will be helping us for the allocation and the deallocation process of semaphore, right? So what are the two segments? That is SEMGT. First one is known as SEMGT, and second one SEMCTL. SEMGT, semaphore gate, and semaphore CT, the semaphore control, is used here for allocate and deallocation of the semaphore. That is similar to like the previous one of SHMGT and SHMCTN for the shared memory. At the time of shared memory, it is SHM shared memory gate and shared memory control. In the case of semaphore, it is semaphore gate and semaphore control. So that invoking this SEMGT, the semaphore gates for segments or with the value of the semaphore, all the permission flags for this will be shared with the memory, or the shared memory will be accessed. In that case, the return value is of the semaphore will be set some identifier. So we can obtain this identifier of an existing semaphore by specifying any value, and this semaphore can continue to exist even after all processes using it have terminated. So the semaphore will be there, but the processes that is attached or deattached or all the things will be terminated, but the semaphore will be there. So the thing is, the last, the very last part is that is using that semaphore has some explicit remove that the OS doesn't run out with the semaphores. So some SEMCT, that is control, that semaphore control will be have some semaphore identifier. The number of semaphores are present in the set and helping the IPC communication for the process. And after the allocation and the deallocation of these two separate operations to initialization of the semaphore, we use this SEMCT again, the semaphore control part, to use the initialization process with zero as a second argument, starting with from the zero a passing argument. And we are creating some array using stereo, the array field for array outside values to initialize this semaphore in the process, for the initialization of the semaphore of the process. Now this, after the initialization of the semaphore, after the semaphore initialization, we can say that in each semaphore, each of the semaphore has some values, and when all the processes are trying to share memory using the semaphore, there are some wait and control operation, some wait operation, some post operation will be there, some wait value, post value, all the things will be there. So what are these wait and post operation, how we can deal with it? So the semop system call will be there, the semaphore operation system call for the implementation of both operations. So what is the thing is named, that is semaphore operation, SEMOP, This system call, the semaphore OP system calls, will be actually helping or implementation for the both operation of wait and post. So the semaphore will be setting some identifier, and then in the second part, that identifier or the operations we are trying to perform will be there. So the stop, we are, this is semaphore buffer system scenario, the start of the semaphore buffer for the buffering process. So first thing, the semaphore num, that is the semaphore number in the semaphore set on which operation is performed. So semaphore num will be there for the operation performance. Semaphore OP will be there for specifying the semaphore operation, finding out a positive number and add it to the semaphore value immediately. And if it is a negative number, then the number will be subtracted for the semaphore value. So some positive value, negative value, and zero condition is there for the wait operation for this semaphore control operation. Positive, negative, and some zero value. If there is zero, then the operation will be blocked until the semaphore value will become zero. So the, if the semaphore operation is getting some zero, the signal is zero, then the value needs to be zero, and till the time the value is zero, that will be, the process will be blocked, right? So waiting operation and the post operation will be helping each other for the memory share or for the access control through the shared memory, right? The second part, we have first talked about the shared memory process. We have write five difference between the memory, shared memory. That is first one, the shared memory permit. Second one, we have write mapped memory pipe scenario of FIFO slash socket. So first one we have done. The next one, that is the mapped memory. In this part, in the context of this mapped memory, so what happens? That it permits the different process to communicate via a shared pipe. In the part of this mapped memory, it permits the different processes to communicate via a shared pipe. So one can think that mapped memory as a sharing memory segment with the name having some technical differences. But the thing is that mapping the memory segment will be very useful for the inter-process communication and is the easy way to access the contents of a file. If we map the memory, if we set the first blocks and then blocks, and the blocks will be mapped. If we map all the memory blocks, then it will be very easy to access the content or access the files from any of the mapped memory location. So this mapped memory actually as an association is working between a file and a process memory. So mapped memory is working and forms an association between the file and process memory, between the file and process memory. So this mapped memory is working as an association between the file and the process memory. And this Linux or this Unix system is have the splitting of this file into page size chunks, that different segment of pages, and then copied into the virtual memory pages where the data or the table entry will be there for each of process address space. This process address can be fixed context with the ordinary memory access and also modify the file. So this map memory, we can say the map memory is as an allocating buffer to hold the file's entire content. So the buffer will be there to hold the memory's entire contents, and to then we can actually read the content of the file. The reading of the file from the buffer and writing the buffer back out afterwards. First, if we are trying to read the data, we are putting the data into the buffer and we are getting the data from that particular buffer. And if we need to change any type of modification, that changes will be done into the buffer side, and then it will be again read back to the memory side, not directly with the memory. So we are working the map. We are creating some mapping memory of the original memory, the segments of the memory. And then the thing is working in the scenario of this memory segment, right? So this map memory is allocating a buffer to hold this file's entire contents for the data and reading and writing operation for the processes also. So this mapping was just like a files process memory. We are using the map signal MMAP, memory map mapping, where these arguments will like to process for the values. So there are two flag value actually. One is map fixed and the one is map private. And third one, there is map shared. So three values, map fixed, map private, and map shared will be there. So what happened if MapFix is there? So MapFix means specifying the flag. The address will request us to map the file with the requested process. So there will be aligned, a page aligned will be there for the map, for the request of the process of this map. Private map private will be write the memory range that should not be write back to the attached file. That will be a private access will be there. And shared, the particular which block will be shared to the particular processes. So these are the flag values that is present in our scenario of this mapping memory segment, right? So after this particular part, we are going to talk or discussing today. No more discussion for today. After this mapping of ordinary file, there will be three other particular processes that we need to talk. So we got to talk in the next classes, but in tomorrow's class. So after this particular part of mapping this memory, the three parameters, there is MapFix, map variable, and map share is used for the mapping memory processes. Right. So up to this, we are going to talk today. Now I would like to request you all for writing the names in the chat box for your attendance purpose. So I can have the record. Fine. So those who have write, that is okay. And those who didn't, kindly write your names in the chat box for your attendance purpose. So this is all for today. We are going to meet again tomorrow in the next class. Right. So by that time, stay safe and take care. Thank you all for joining to the session. We will meet again tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.